Thank you very much for the introduction. And there we are.
Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. We will take this opportunity to tell you about our research work on developing new kind of vision technology for artificial intelligence systems. That will be the in silico part.
And for the in vivo, in fact, artificial vision systems, it's not only an algorithm. It's optics, it's a sensor, and that's what this talk is about.
And before we dive into the talk, let us take a little recap on what is actually vision. Vision is a tool that uses light to probe properties of objects out there in the environment. Why light? Why light is special? First, it allows us distance sensing. We don't have to actually go to an object and touch it and interact with it in one way, mechanical or chemical. Meaning that light sensing is also non-invasive. We don't change the state of the system, of the object that we are observing too much. And light is basically free. It literally is falling from the sky. So now the question is, how can we use light in order to extract some useful properties about the environment?
So to be able to use light, you actually need one of these visual systems. And one of these visual systems would actually be composed of three parts. Something usually that modifies light's properties, converts light into light, for instance, to make it converge. That's the optics. And that, for instance, that would make it converge onto a sensor, the part that actually takes light and converts it into another signal that we can better deal with. Finally, this sensor would typically actually forward information to a processor to extract relevant pieces of information.
Interestingly, if you look at the biology, we have the same segregation. We have the optical part of the system, which is the pupil, the cornea, and your eye lenses, that transfers optical energy back into optical energy and concentrates on the sensor. In the human eye, the sensor would be the retina on the back of your eye. In animals, it could be some light-sensitive cells that convert optical energy into electrochemical signals that then go to our processor, which is the brain. Now, in biology, all these three components are tightly interacted. And biology kind of plays with them through evolution to create a multitude of different visual systems. Even more importantly, all these different visual systems, they are there for different purposes. So as Darwin put it, in nature, there's an eye for every purpose. So now let's have a look at a few examples of interesting visual systems in biology.
So in fact, before we go into any interesting visual system, let's talk about boring ones. And the boring ones would be the ones of, for instance, this 50 micrometer unique cell that has just a bag of pigments, which is photosensitive. Why is that useful? Because that pigments could actually just distinguish light from darkness, which is useful for photoperiodism. You don't have the same activity during the day and during night. Now, if you go slightly more complicated and you start to deepen these pigments actually into some hole, then you can start to distinguish and differentiate light directions. Why? Maybe, for instance, to follow light sources.
So let's now have a look at a bit more complex animals, for instance, this mollusk. It does have a little neural system and a sensor already, but its optics is very, very simple. It just uses a pinhole as an optical system. Those of you who are wearing glasses might know, if you look through a pinhole, that suddenly world becomes sharp. So what pinhole allows us to do is to put everything, every point in the scene in focus, and we can see sharp everywhere. Very simple optical system.
Now this has a drawback. You are actually not very sensitive to light. So what does human do? Humans enlarge this aperture, but this comes at some expense. You only see some part of the scene actually in focus, and you need to develop optics to actually be able to see different things in focus and use your accommodation. Interestingly, this design of this circular aperture for human is actually not widely spread in nature. Let's look at this domestic goat with a horizontal aperture. It turns out that horizontal apertures, or vertical aperture for the tree viper, for instance, turn out to put certain things which are out of focus, meaning, for instance, here, to put the emphasis on certain features. If you have a horizontal aperture, you will typically better see lines which are horizontal in the background, while if you have vertical aperture, you will better see lines which are actually vertical. Why? This is some ecological advantage. If you're a snake and you're crawling on a 2D surface, maybe you're interested in seeing features which are actually vertical. Now, if you're a domestic goat, maybe you're actually interested in elevation and knowing where horizon is. It turns out that actually these are mostly herbivores and these are mostly carnivores.
Okay, let's look at the next example of an interesting system. A chameleon, as a predator, needs to catch prey, needs to estimate distance to the prey. However, it cannot use stereo vision for that because his eyes are on the side of the head. They don't overlap, so it cannot use stereo. What can it use? It uses a different signal, and you can also test this signal. We also have it. So if you try to focus on your finger and move it closer and farther away from your eye, you can notice a certain muscle tension as you get closer. So there's some motor signal there that can be used to estimate depth. And that's what Chameleon is using. So the Chameleon can actively change the optical strength of its lens, focus on different objects in the scene, and by that estimate depth to them. Catch the break.
So we have talked about apertures, we have talked about optics, we have talked about slightly different sensors. Now, if you want to go in really complex optical systems and complex eyes, we can actually look at what is happening in insects. So in insects, you have these compound eyes that actually consist of hundreds of thousands of little eyes with their own little optical element and their little photosensitive cell here. Interestingly, you might use these optical elements to increase your field of view. That turns out to be very useful during flight, for instance, to be able to estimate motion. Now, if you're a nocturnal insect, you use these little optical elements to do something different. You collect more light, you make them converge on the same photosensitive cell, and you suddenly increase your sensitivity to light.
So I hope that with these few examples, we have shown to you that nature is really playing with the whole visual system, with the pupil and the sensor and the optics and the process at the end to come up with a variety of different eyes. And all these different eyes serve different purposes. They have different ecological advantages. Now, let's look in technology. In technology, we also need visual systems for different purposes. And they should have different properties. One camera needs to be very, very fast because it's in a fast-moving vehicle or a drone. Another camera needs very high resolution because it's there to recognize faces or to some other complex patterns. Some camera might be there to detect depth, you know, to build virtual reality or maybe avoid obstacles on a drone. And some might need to be very, very low power because they need surveillance application. They need to run 24/7. Now, if you look into our technology, however, it seems that the cameras that we try to use for all these different purposes are basically the same. They use more or less the same optics, maybe with a little bit of zoom, but otherwise the optics is fixed. And the same sensor, you know, the CMOS sensor. We just accumulate light in some short time intervals and produce images. And the whole burden of extracting useful information from our light interacting with the environment for a particular task is offloaded on the processor, on the computer. And we have all the smart algorithms that compute all kinds of things. This is, of course, a way to go, obviously. But our question is it the only way to go, and if it's the best one?
Can we design these new vision devices to fulfill a particular purpose, tuned for a particular purpose, not only the processor, but the optics and the sensor? So that would really go in this field of what people would call computational imaging, if that's a term that you can actually remember. Interestingly, trying to sense directly the relevant aspects of the world might alleviate a lot the burden actually put on the processor side. Let's say we're interested in motion. Now, with conventional cameras, you would take a succession of frames that are static snapshots of the world. Why not having a sensor that would only report parts of the scene that actually change, low data rate, and other advantages? Another sensor we will actually present now is what happens if you're actually in scenes or in cases with scenes with very, very bright regions and very, very dark regions. Just because of the inherent working principle of conventional CMOS sensor, this accumulation of photons during a particular time is actually turned out to be pretty bad if you have very, very high illumination on a pixel, which then saturates, or if you have very low illumination on a pixel, which then just is bathed in the darkness and cannot see anything. And finally, what actually I would like to put back into question is why should we actually use these sensors, which is projecting the three-dimensional world we are trying to understand on a 2D image plane? Could we actually devise sensors that are able to capture the structure of the world, this three-dimensional world, more naturally?
So let's look at a few examples of these unconventional sensors. And the first one will be the dynamic vision sensor developed at our lab here at ETH. This sensor gives away the notion of image completely. There are no images produced by this sensor. The pixels are not read out simultaneously at some moment in time. Instead, each pixel asynchronously for itself detects luminance change. When something became brighter or darker, the pixel reports this change as an event back to the computer. By doing that, instead of images that come at certain moments in time, we have a sequence of events that continuously flows out of our sensor with microsecond resolution, because each event is a very tiny package. It costs nothing to send it out. So we have a completely different representation of visual information. What can it be good for?
Well, the question is what we do with this representation. And as the title of the slide indicated, it's actually good for motion. So here we are representing our input, and actually it turns out to be very, very easy, for instance, here, to extract rotation of the camera at a sub-millisecond accuracy. Here we're actually talking about 10 microseconds to be able to update the rotation of the camera. Interestingly, even though this might look very strange to you and very far from an image, information is not lost, and you can actually perfectly reconstruct images at an arbitrary time resolution. And here we're seeing Julia and myself preparing the talk. Now, we're actually going one step further. We can embed this in very small devices working at less than 100 milliwatts of power to be actually able to do localization mapping as Margarita presented before.
Let's go to our second example. We don't have to be so extreme and give up images completely. We can still keep images, but do them differently and alleviate one of the problems which many of you who do photography might know. If you have a bright window and you want to make someone's photograph, it's difficult, right? Because the bright window will be over-illuminated, overexposed. You won't see anything where the things are too bright in the image. You could do differently. You could select exposure in such a way that you see the bright region just right. You can see everything that is brightly illuminated, but then the rest of the scene will be lost in darkness because you don't have enough time to collect light there. What we actually would like to see is an image something like this, where you see both the well-lit region and the darker regions equally well, so that you can observe both types of the scene. Is it possible?
So this has been done actually for a long time. People have typically taken these two images and found some nice optimization to actually obtain this image. What we propose here is slightly different. It's this perspective of changing the sensor. So in fact, we're going to create a sensor where each pixel works independently of its neighbor and is going to say, stop, I had enough light, or please continue, I would actually need to receive more light. So typically in these two scenarios, very high illumination and very low illumination, if a pixel was able to say, hey, I had enough light here, it should look very much like the one there. And this is typically what we get. Here, typically as well, if we actually want to see through the stained glass, here this pixel receives way too much light, I'm going to stop integrating much earlier.
So if you're not really interested in looking into lamps and asking yourself what is it good for, then you might remember the car accident with Tesla when over the bright sky, the visual system was not able to recognize a white truck coming. In driving scenarios, such situations can come very, very often. So on a sunny day on the street, you can have a dark tunnel out of which a tram might be coming, which you will lose with the usual visual system, tuned now to see the brightly lit street. On the other hand, you could tune your system to see in the dark tunnel, but then you lose all the information about the street and, for instance, the pedestrian that is out there. With our sensor, you would rather get a picture like this, where you can both see the well-lit street and look inside the tunnel and won't have the problem at all. And you do it at low power and very fast.
So the last sensor we want to try to present to you is this sensor that tries to actually capture the three-dimensional structure of the scene slightly more naturally. So for this, it's going to be a joint work with the optics and the sensing elements. And let's use actually this principle of this chameleon and try to actually design a system which weakness is the strength, meaning if you don't see many things in focus and that you can actually put different things in focus, for instance, here the USB stick and before we had the remote control, here the cup and here the blackboard, this can be used in our advantage. If you can actually assess sharpness and relate this sharpness to depth, then you can actually be able to recover depth at all time. Now, interestingly, this is also a method that existed. You actually compute some filters and you get maximal response when depth is actually at that particular distance you have focus. Now, we actually made a system that allows us to do that within the sensor and the optics.
What do we need in order to build this system? So first, we need to be able to change the focal strength of our device. So we need a lens that can vibrate, that can change its focal strength. And such a lens existed, so in collaboration with OptoTune AG, a company here in Zurich, we got access to such liquid lens that can breathe, that you can vibrate and change its focal strength very quickly, 200 times per second. Now, the second element that we need is to compute which pixels are in focus in many, many images. So you have to do it very, very fast. On the computer, you actually won't be able to do it so fast. So we use a special sensor for that, again in collaboration with Manchester, where every pixel is a little processor on its own. So in order to compute anything, you don't need to offload information to the computer. You can actually compute on the sensor, and by that be very, very fast. And we can then get the results that look like
yes.
this.
Yes, so with this system, we're able to get a new depth frame, so something that tells you how far in red or how far in blue and how close in red is, about 128 levels, and we run the system actually up to 300 frames per second. And this, you can assess the quality of these depth maps. Now, it's very complicated. These sensors are very low resolution, and we are very early in actually building these new type of sensing devices.
So to conclude, I hope that we could convince you that in nature, there is a multitude of different eyes. They're all evolved by changing the optics, the pupil, the sensor, and the brain at the same time, by co-evolving the whole visual system. And evolution has tuned each of this visual system for a particular purpose, to be really optimal for the ecological niche of the animal. And our goal is to create a technology that also does that, that is tuned for a particular task. And in order to do that, we have to change the whole system and to be able to play and design the whole system.
Optics, sensor, and processor, evolving the visual systems, as Darwin put it, to have an eye for each intent and purpose. And the goal of our research is actually to get a camera, a computational sensor for each intent and purpose. And on this, I thank you very much for your attention. And this work would not be possible without all our collaborators at ETH, the University, University of Manchester, TU Munich, Stockholm, and the Swiss National Fund. Thank you very much.